So thanks, everybody, for coming out. Really appreciate it on a beautiful day. I'm Chris Sprigman. I'm a professor here at the law school, and we're going to have a session today called Copyright versus Creativity. Is intellectual property reserved for the 1%? Now, the meaning of that title, I think, is going to become clear over the course of the session. We are going to talk about copyright and culture and imitation in China, and what comic books have to say about all of this through the agency of a book that we'll be talking a bit about today, Ricky Rouse Has a Gun. And this book has been written by Jörg, who's two seats to my left. So I'm going to introduce everybody on this panel. I'm going to let Jörg kick it off, and then we're going to get to it. So Jörg Tittel writes, produces, and directs plays, films, and video games. His passion and long-term mission is to create beautifully crafted stories and character-driven projects at cross-media platforms. So Jörg was born in Belgium, but he went to school here at NYU at the Tisch School of the Arts. And then he spent some time in LA, where he designed video games for Activision and some other companies. He worked in particular on the Minority Report video game based on the Spielberg film. More recently, Jörg has lived in London, where he's worked on projects like 2 plus 2 plus 2, which is a play starring one of my favorite actors, Richard E. Grant. And he produced a film, Testudo, which was in competition at festivals in Krakow, Raindance, and East End Film Festival. His latest film is Battle for Britain in 2010, which starred Julian Glover and has been shown at Oscar-qualifying film festivals in Newport Beach, Cleveland, and Krakow. Charles Brownstein is immediately to my left. He served as executive director of the Comic Book Legal Defense Fund since 2002. So during his years at the helm of the organization, he successfully managed several First Amendment cases involving comic books and participated in a wide variety of challenges to unconstitutional legislation. Under Brownstein's watch, the Comic Book Legal Defense Fund has grown its budget to accommodate a full-time staff of three people, has moved to New York City, and has mounted an increasingly vital program of events across the United States. Charles also writes a lot about comics, and he's a very lively writer. I recommend you take a look at some of his writing and comic book resources, Comics Journal, Publishers Weekly, Wizard, Comic-Con.com, and other venues. Barton Beebe, all the way to my left, is a professor here at NYU. He specializes in the doctrinal, empirical, and cultural analysis of IP law. He's been the Ann Urowski Visiting Professor of Law at Yale Law School and a Visiting Professor of Law at Stanford Law School. And he's taught courses in Strasbourg, in Munich, in China, in Finland. Recently, Barton's been interested in the Shansai culture of China, which we'll talk a little bit about today, and how it interacts with Western ideas about creativity and the ownership of intellectual property. So I wanted to call on Jörg to get us started. Tell us a little bit about Ricky Rouse Has a Gun. What motivated you to write it? A little bit about what it's about, and just give us some background, and we'll get started.
Well, I had no original ideas, so I just decided I should just rip people off. I was living in LA at the time, and I was sort of a budding screenwriter. I'd actually just finished working on that Minority Report thing, and I wasn't particularly happy working in cubicles and sort of making branded product. And so I was so happy to be this free budding screenwriter, and then the first thing I get offered is Conan the Barbarian prequel to write. And so I thought, oh God, I'm never going to get out of this thing. And then I realized that everything was actually based on brands, and everything was sequels and prequels and remakes. And of course, nothing has changed. It's only gotten more and more so. And then, of course, everyone was talking about the threat from China and the rising power, and America is crumbling and the empire is going down and China's going to eat us alive and all that kind of stuff. And everyone was buying iPhones suddenly, and iPhones were, of course, all made in China, and we heard about children making them and all that kind of stuff. So all these things sort of, I think, probably created some weird, dangerous cocktail in my mind, and that's how I came up with this silliness.
So can you tell us a little bit about what the book's about?
Oh, yes. It's Ricky Rouse tells the story of a U.S. war deserter called Richard Rouse, and he actually runs away from Afghanistan and also becomes estranged of his wife and daughter, and moves to China, where he gets a job in a knockoff Disney theme park outside Shanghai as Ricky Rouse, named after him, where he has to greet tourists as this big rip-off rodent. And then on Christmas Day, when he finally sees his daughter again after a couple years, the whole park gets taken hostage by terrorists who happen to be American terrorists in rip-off mascot outfits. So It's a very serious book. And I think it has a very profound thing to say about the world around us. No, the only reason it actually has any sort of intelligence about it whatsoever is because Chris, here present, wrote this beautiful foreword for it. So if for nothing else, I hope you pick up a copy because his foreword is absolutely brilliant.
So I had the feeling that, you know, there's always the question of literary interpretation, right? Is the interpreter actually supplying the meaning? I don't think I'm supplying the meaning. I think I am actually drawing some meaning out of the text. So what attracted me to write the foreword, obviously, is, you know, I like you, but also I thought the book was really interesting, had a really interesting take on what copying means, especially what copying means in China. So can you tell us a little bit about that message and what Ricky Rouse, I mean, stands for as too much of a distillation? But you see what I'm getting at.
Yeah, I mean, you know, what is a ripoff, firstly? I mean, you know, as I briefly alluded to, you know, at the beginning, you know, I feel that, I mean, of course, you know, seeing ripoff products and seeing a Burger Queen or, you know, a Kentucky, is it Obama Fried Chicken?
Obama Fried Chicken, yeah.
Yeah, they had those in China. I mean, it's silly, and I really doubt that those things have really hurt, you know, KFC's sort of bottom line, really. But you know, they were sued out of existence very quickly, and that's good. But I'm personally also really quite worried about, you know, us in the West ripping ourselves off quite a lot, not just individual creatives getting their ideas stolen in Hollywood, for instance, but. But more importantly, you know, having, you know, 20th century ideas, you know, reheated ad infinitum to a point where I think they're basically losing all of their nutritional value, you know, or culturally nutritional value. And I feel like that's a problem because I think the more we make prequels, sequels, remakes, and et cetera, the less newer generations will take our creative input seriously and the more likely I feel they will also feel inclined to pirate it or download it for free, because if it's just a branded product, it's essentially advertisement. And why should you pay for advertisement? We're used to getting Facebook for free. We're used to doing all our communications essentially for free. So why shouldn't we also consume entertainment for free if it's basically just a bunch of brands? So, and I'm really worried about that as a creative person, because creative and original ideas are considered risky. And if you sort of translate that down to the freedom of speech and communications in general, then anyone who actually has an original thought becomes dangerous. And I think there's a very dangerous connotation there for us.
So two questions, one about Hollywood and the other about the setting of this book. So is there something that's changed about Hollywood, the business of Hollywood or the culture of Hollywood, that's led to this practice, which I think a lot of people have noticed casually, right? I don't know if people have studied it rigorously. But I think people have noticed casually there's an awful lot of reheating going on, right? So toys become movies, movies become board games, video games become movies, movies become video. There's this tremendous traffic between platforms, which isn't necessarily bad, but a lot of it is the kind of reheating of the same ideas. Why is that happening, if you have a view?
I mean, I'd be curious to hear what you guys think, really. I mean, there is the risk-averse thing. And it's funny because I've had a couple of conversations with people that sort of lead the sort of anti-piracy whatever activities in Hollywood, and basically, you know, all the studios group together and they form some bodies and then they go to Washington and they talk to them about, you know, then we need more protection against pirates and blah blah blah, and we need to have more powers. And they believe that the reason that there's less originality coming out of Hollywood is because it's less risky because we're all being hurt by pirates, and the pirates, you know, cost Hollywood billions every year or something, and therefore it's much better to avoid losing even more cash. Let's make stuff that people instantly recognize as being, you know, like Spider-Man and Spider-Man 17 and whatever. That's much better than an original idea that might fail or is more likely to fail. So it's not their fault. They're not being creative. It's our fault for sort of downloading stuff on BitTorrents. So if piracy, as long as piracy exists, Hollywood feels legitimized to, you know, to make more and more prequels because that's supposedly risk averse. But I mean, that's one thing. And the other thing is, you know, studios are not run by the same people that they were run by 30, 40, 50 years ago. And now they're mostly run by banks. So, and bankers, you know, don't tend to you know, like original ideas and change unless they're the ones behind the change.
So there's another theory that's been ventured, and I'd like to get your reaction to it, that this is an incident of globalization. So the audience for movies is globalizing, and you know, there are cross-cultural differences that prevent an intensely, I don't know, American movie from doing very well necessarily abroad. And so in a sense, you de-indigenize films. You make Transformers, right? Which is a film that crosses cultural boundaries more readily than, say, you know, some mumblecore film from Brooklyn. Is there anything to that, or is that overstated?
Well, I think there is, but I think it's really funny that Michael Bay would make a Transformers. I think we're at 4 at the moment. And then sort of make this entire sequence or even a third of the movie and set it in China so he can touch Chinese money, Chinese audiences more, et cetera. But he comes from the same studio and also essentially has made movies in the past where Asians and Easterners are terrorists and really scary people that, you know, take a look at Olympus Has Fallen, I think it was.
That's a great example.
And you say, Olympus Has Fallen, which of course is a diehard ripoff completely, as is White House Down, which is a ripoff of Olympus Has Fallen, which, anyway, go on forever. And that one has like really scary North Koreans coming and blowing up the White House.
Well, the recent Scarlett Johansson vehicle has a lot of very scary, you know, Hong Kong Chinese as well. So there's definitely a meme there. And I wonder how those films travel.
Well, Transformers 4 did very well in China. So that's, you know, so of course, you know, Michael Bay will be very encouraged by that. And he'll make the fifth one and, you know, there.
The Transformers transform into something interesting in the fifth one. So, okay, so last question. China. What's going on in China right now that makes it the best place to set this book in your mind?
Well, I mean, it's a world of possibilities. I mean, like the human rights track record aside, but, you know, of course I'm here in the States now and just recently seen what happened in Ferguson, so perhaps we're not much better here in the supposed West. But anyway, in China, it's a world of possibilities. I mean, you have people like Stephen Chow, who's an awesome Chinese director, and his movies are completely out of their mind and very expensive and very, very ambitious. And at the same time, they're also very overtly critical of the Chinese class structure and what's happening economically and it shows, you know, local government corruption and stuff. Even something as silly as Kung Fu Hustle or Shaolin Soccer shows that off very well. So the Chinese are actually through comedy and through satire and stuff. And a lot of people, I've always heard that so often, oh, Ricky Rouse, nobody in China will get that. They don't have a sense of humor. The Chinese don't understand sarcasm. Like, really? First of all, I find that profoundly racist. And second of all, Chinese cinema is hilarious, or can be hilarious. So I think it's over there, you know, they make, in a way it's brilliant because our culture is having to repeat itself more and more in order to supposedly sell more easily in China, whereas and there's only a very limited amount of American films that get to be released there. So they have to be these branded things. So now we feel obliged to make this branded crap. Sorry. And at the same time, the Chinese have, you know, a world full of possibilities, and they come up with the creative stuff. So these government regulations over there seem to be encouraging creativity, you know, and thwarting ours.
So Charles, I wanted to get you involved in this, and what I looking at this book when I first read it, I thought, well, there are copyright issues here, and there are trademark issues, and you know, we all hope that Jörg doesn't get sued. But this is a law school, and comic books are, graphic novels are the ground of a lot of legal disputes. You've been neck deep in these things. I'd just like to get a sense of your history in this area and what you think the legal issues are that crop up time and again with this type of creative work.
Sure. For those that are unaware of it, I'm the executive director of the Comic Book Legal Defense Fund, and we're a nonprofit organization that protects the freedom to read. We've been around since 1986, and in almost 30 years have assisted in the legal defense or litigated a variety of cases involving protection of the First Amendment. The core kind of case that we tend to work with tends in the area of obscenity or harmful to minors, where people are actually facing criminal charges for the sale or display of content that runs afoul, supposedly, of obscenity laws. Or in the 1990s, it became harmful to minors, which is a category of law that is state-to-state granted that says this material is protected as to adults, but cannot be sold or displayed as to minors. And there's a whole battery of issues regarding free expression that are adjacent to the copyright discussion here that I won't belabor, but that's really one of the core areas in which we do our work. In recent years, we've seen that work increase into challenges to expression on the school, library, and university level with regard to banned books and book censorship. And that is actually the second largest area in which we conduct our work. In fact, this week is Banned Books Week, the annual celebration of the freedom to read. And you can check out our website, cbldf.org, and see how, you know, this is still a big issue that, you know, in South Carolina, there was a funding battle in a university to, the state wanted to take away money from the university because they assigned Fun Home by Alison Bechdel, who this week won the MacArthur Genius Grant, because they disagreed with it. And that almost happened, you know, and they arrived at this bogus unconstitutional compromise to use that money to teach the Constitution. That's the second area. Copyright is, you know, a third area that we've done a fair amount of work in, but it actually doesn't pop up as often as one might think. There's a preoccupation that creators bring to the table about, you know, am I going to be sued for satirizing or parodying an idea? Those things do happen. It's not the most, you know, frequent expression that happens, but the ones where they have been really chilling. In your introduction, you referenced a very famous 1970s case involving a group who called themselves the Air Pirates, who were these hippies in San Francisco that were led by a prankster named Dan O'Neill, and he gathered cartoonists including Sherry Flanagan, who went on to work for National Lampoon, Bobby London, who went on to do work and still does work for Playboy, Ted Richards, who was a famous underground cartoonist of the day, and made these comics that directly and by name satirized the Disney characters Mickey Mouse, Minnie Mouse, Donald Duck, Daisy Duck, and showed them engaged in adult behaviors. And so they're smuggling drugs, and they're having sex, and they're in shootouts, and, you know, all of these things that, you know, were high humor in both the figurative and wacky tobacky sense of it. And this was, you know, deliberately baiting Disney. It was one of those things where it didn't get noticed, they didn't get sued, they put out two issues of it. And if you read this wonderful book by Bob Levin called The Pirates Versus the Mouse, he actually had to give the book to one of his stoner friends that was the son of somebody on the Disney board to get them to look at it and provoke a lawsuit. And so, you know, ultimately, at the end of this very long and twisting, convoluted case where they named Mickey Mouse by name, they drew Mickey Mouse's penis, they had the covers look exactly like a Dell comic but changed the word Dell to hell, you arrived at this, you know, decision that ultimately said that this, you know, this stuff is not permissible. And
is Mickey Mouse's penis patented as well, or is there a specific way you have to draw it?
Well, that's tarnishment. That's brand tarnishment. Okay. And there's a serious case to be made there because, you know, copyright is designed to fully protect what a creator fully creates, and it's been, you know, twisted in ways, you know, post 1978 to permit a corporation to be a legal author and to carry on the ownership of something, you know, indefinitely. You know, this is a 21st century problem that law schools and creative people are going to have to figure out. But this particular case was one of the earliest ones to kind of usher in the 21st century issues that Jörg is talking about here. More recently, and more close to the bone of what really happens, because Dan's case and the Air Pirates case was an extraordinary case of just idealism, stubbornness, and, you know, 1960s sensibilities bleeding into the area of law. More frequently now, you'll see people making parodies of corporate marks being silenced by way of the cease and desist, being silenced by way of the lawsuit that they know there's absolutely no way this person can defend. And so, for instance, in 2000, the Comic Book Legal Defense Fund defended a cartoonist named Kieran Dwyer, who had drawn a parody of the Starbucks logo, which, you know, we all know her, right? She's in this green circle and she's holding coffee cups, and you know, she began topless, and over time, as they went and that became a national brand, they decided to cover her up. And he drew this character with dollar signs in her eyes, and instead of saying Starbucks coffee, it said consumer whore. And so this was on the cover of his comic, it was within a story on his comic, it was on a t-shirt. And so Starbucks sued in California and said, you can't do this with our mark. This is a tarnishment and a dilution of this mark that we've built up tremendous goodwill over time. And so we helped Kieran with his defense, and we raised money for his defense. And ultimately, the California court came down with a unusual decision that I think will probably be revisited over time, which said that in the body of a story, fair game. On the cover of a comic book, on a t-shirt, it's a piece of merchandise that is, in fact, diluting Starbucks' brand. So he's not allowed to use this drawing in those fields because that's merchandise and not necessarily the same level of expression as one would find in a story. And, you know, Kieran got to the end game here and realized, well, do I want to go on fighting and continue this? Because one of the things you're going to deal with, if any of you deal with actual clients, as opposed to, you know, dealing with the kind of, you know, office side of and business side of litigation, is that it's a tremendously stressful thing. You know, being the target of a lawsuit, being engaged in a criminal case, is one of the worst experiences a human being can engage with. And so it's very easy for those of us on the side of the idealism of constitutional law to advocate for fight all the way and make the point. You know, you often wind up with really broken people, and Kieran decided, you know, I'm out, you know, before this goes on further. And you really can't criticize somebody for that because it's tremendously stressful. And, you know, we were able to help raise the money, but if we weren't, he would have been bankrupted.
I mean, there are also right of publicity claims, right? So there are, I'll give you a couple examples of comic books. There's a comic book right of publicity claim involving a hockey player, Tony Twistelli, right? It's an enforcer in the NHL, one of the kind of thugs.
Tony Twist is his name, but the character
Twistelli in the comic. The kind of thug in the comic.
Yeah.
So Tony Twist, the hockey player, sues and says, you know, you can't use my likeness for commercial purposes, right? Even though the likeness is being used as part of a story.
Sure.
Another example, the Winter Brothers, these rock and roll kind of C-listers who have a very distinctive look. You know, they're albino, long hair, very tall, very thin. There are a couple of characters in a comic book that basically take their heads and put them onto the body of worms,
yes,
if I remember correctly.
Yeah. as the Autumn Brothers. They didn't use them by name.
Not the Winter Brothers. The Autumn Brothers. So everyone who was a fan of C-list rock and roll in the 70s knew what this was about, so all five of us. And again, this drew a right of publicity lawsuit. So these things come up from time to time.
Yes.
Is the direction of the law more permissive over time of this use, or is it pretty static?
It's all still looking for guidance. Right of publicity, there's, you know, three prevailing tests. With regard to it, the Supreme Court hasn't had a case rise to the level where they're providing guidance on which way to go. And so this proposes to creators that you've got a couple of routes that you can go on. You can avoid this area entirely, you know, or you can confront this area head on. And if you're doing your work for a business that, you know, is concerned about these issues, so, you know, if you're doing this work for a corporation that is supporting your efforts, they might say, even if you're a creator-owned book, you know, we don't particularly want to go down this road, you know, please go a different direction. And that's absolutely within their business rights to do. You know, what Jörg has done here is, you know, confronted it very gently. You know, I don't think that there's any reality in which this book is anything but parody. I think that you've made it, you know, very clearly parody within all of the various jurisdictions, you know, in the United States and around the globe where this would occur. But you bring attention to the issue that we have infused a great deal of our creative power in these icons. And, you know, this stuff isn't getting sorted out anytime soon. And so it's really up to your generation, and much more importantly, the generation of content creators that, you know, are just now starting to realize that I can do this, to determine which way we want to go. Do we want to create wholly new IP within the alternative funding mechanisms, or do we want to work within the traditional funding mechanisms and be subject either to doing endless fan fiction until these particular marks are no longer viable and they need to exploit something else, or do we decide that I'm going to tell a wholly original story and I'm going to develop a new audience, which we've seen funding mechanisms like crowdfunding and, you know, other alternative methods come to be. So really all of this comes down to follow the money, you know, and if you're a content creator, which area do you want to exploit your intellectual property and your ideas?
So I do want to talk about that a bit later. I do want to talk about what we do with these icons, icons like Mickey Mouse. Do we talk back to them? Do they talk to us, right? Is there supposed to be a conversation about them, or are they supposed to be somebody's property? The meaning is stable. That's an incredibly interesting topic to me, at least. But before we do that, I want to get Barton in here, who has been thinking a lot about the meaning of appropriation in China and the meaning of this, I think, distinctive culture that has arisen in China that uses appropriation for ends that may be a little different than the typical American model.
Yeah, so I should actually say first that I'm really gratified by the content of this discussion, because as a trademark person, trademark is really in my heart versus copyright law. The title is Copyright versus Creativity, but you'll notice that a lot of what we've been talking about is trademark law and the use of brands in literature, and it makes complete sense. I mean, we see this especially now in virtual reality environment. Some of my students are here and have heard me talk about this before, but if you want to make a virtual reality game, it's very difficult to do so without incorporating trademarks, because everywhere you look in New York, you see trademarks. If you want to have a virtual reality game that involves Times Square, you've got a big problem, because you've got hundreds of very powerful brand names that you have to include if you want to project some degree of reality. And so it makes good sense to me that a graphic novel would actually be engaging this issue directly of how do you represent reality when so much of it is propertized? And I guess you can do so parodically, but what if you don't want to be parodic? What if you want to be something other than parodic and it becomes very difficult? I guess as far as the Chinese example, what I just wanted to put on the record quickly was the example of Shan Chai. And I know that there are some Mandarin speakers here who will laugh at my accent, but the basic idea of Shan Chai and the Mandarin characters are shown here is it's used as a description for copying practices in China that are essentially sort of appropriationist, possibly parodic, possibly oftentimes commercial, but not necessarily all the time commercial, and in general, very hard to describe, completely unpredictable, and incredibly creative. So let me show you quickly some examples of this. First, the iPhone 6, I realize it prints very small on the screen, but the iPhone 6 is already coming out in imitation iPhone 6s in China. Like the day that Apple had its events, iPhone 6s were being released in China, known as Sunshine iPhone 6s. But other examples from the iPhone 5 era, you'd have things like the HiPhone, the iPhono, the iPhone Mini, all these different variations that cell phone manufacturers, primarily in the Shenzhen area of China, were manufacturing very rapidly. And one argument is that this is a form of innovation, that these manufacturers could react like within a week. It was like fast fashion, but high technology goods, an incredible phenomenon that started to develop in China. Harry Potter also has been the subject of a lot of copies. So here you have Harry Potter and the Giant Funnel. This was a completely new book someone wrote that was just like a Harry Potter spin-off. It was like fan fiction, but published on a mass scale in China. Then you have the great example of Dafen Village in China, where there are hundreds of artists who create copies of old master paintings. Some of them will specialize just in clouds, others will do the river, others will do the grass, and it's essentially an assembly line of these copies. And of course, as you can imagine, a lot of cultural theorists from the West have just like descended on Dafen Village, because it's an incredibly interesting phenomenon that continues even with all of these Westerners walking around taking photos, thinking it's like this cool postmodern Baudrillardian sort of thing. Very interesting then also is the practice in China that I find just so interesting and hard to understand and hard to resist fitting into Western categories of that were associated with this term postmodernity, which I don't use except in scare quotes, but the practice of all of these copy monuments in China. So you have here like Stonehenge in China, the Arc de Triomphe, the Eiffel Tower. This is all from Window on the World near Hong Kong and Shenzhen, where you can see all of these different world monuments very quickly in one place. And then you have knockoff villages, entire villages that are copies of German or Austrian villages. And so the question is, to conclude, you know, so what's going on here? What are these practices doing? Are they oppositional? I mean, I'd like to think that they are oppositional, that they are parodic in a way, that they are sort of very colloquial, taking the piss out of Western culture in a way and making fun of all of these grand Western monuments. But when the Americans were doing it, when the Americans built Harvard and Yale and Princeton to copy Oxbridge, were they making fun? No, they weren't. It was some sort of homage, but there was no homage. It wasn't like a campy homage. It was pretty much straight. It was like they were trying to copy. So the open question is, what is going on in these Shunchai practices? And I think I'll leave it open, actually, and just say a lot of people are wondering about this. One proposal is it's oppositional, it's political. Another is that it's not political at all, it's just commercial. In the tradition, here I'll actually conclude, oh, so here you've got all these examples of like Adidas shoes that are also branded Nike, Hike shoes and the rest, but very quickly I'll mention, as far as political opposition, there is the phenomenon of Shunchai Olympic torch relay. Sorry, this is from a presentation. Well, I'll tell you that there are some practices that are explicitly oppositional, that are trying to oppose the Communist Party, and those have been suppressed more aggressively than the intellectual property imitations. We can talk about that if you wish.
So I wanted to pick up on that, Barton. You know, you're asking a question about what Shunzai means, and you know, my thinking about this is Shunzai is actually of a piece with what's going on in the West. It's just expressed differently. So let me try to explain what I mean by that. So when Jörg came to me to write the foreword for his book, I said yes, you know, again, in part because I like Jörg, but also in part because I thought this book had something really interesting to say about appropriation. So Richard Rouse goes to China, and he's pretty down and out, and he gets a job at this knockoff theme park that's populated by all these Western cultural icons that have been renamed and redone a little bit. And he puts on the suit of the kind of biggest Western cultural icon, you know, of them all, Mickey Mouse, and becomes Ricky Rouse, right? Which is kind of funny. there's something going on there that's, you know, I wasn't aware that there was MR confusion, but fair enough. But there's also this notion of what Ricky Rouse is about. So at one point, Richard Rouse, the man, says to the theme park owner, he says, so isn't this just a ripoff of Mickey Mouse? And I think this is a really important moment in the book. The theme park owner gets really pissed off and says, no, this is actually a Chinese original, right? This is a new thing, right? And I thought, yeah, that's actually gets at, I think, what's going on in China, what I've seen with Shunzai, which is, you know, there's an embrace, in a sense, of Western culture, but it's such a tight embrace. It's a little bit suffocating in a sense. So it's not simply an acceptance of Western culture. It's holding it so close that it changes, right? That it's re-indigenizing it. It's re-explaining it in a way that might be hostile, that might not be hostile. It kind of depends on the situation. But there's a creative impulse at work here to kind of recontextualize Mickey Mouse for this different culture. And I think that the book really gets at that without, you know, without kind of the academic way of getting at it. It gets at it in a very direct kind of artistic narrative way that I really appreciated when I looked at this. So what does that mean? So I think Shunzai can go in a lot of directions. I think it can be an opposition to American cultural dominance. I think it can be used to send political messages to the Chinese government. But I think it also can just be people being creative and having fun, right? I think it can be just people being snotty. Mm-hmm. It can be just people having their say about something. And in that respect, I think this is a manifestation of something much more broad that's happening. And I just think about my own childhood, right? So I always loved to write. And when I was a kid, I thought, you know, what would my life be as a writer? I thought, well, maybe I'll be a newspaper reporter, right? So I was a newspaper reporter in college. And I did a lot of writing. I did a lot of feature writing, not just news, but features. And, you know, we people who wrote back in that day, we thought of ourselves as a small group of people, and we thought of ourselves as having some status. And we were talking to people, right? It was a broadcast culture. Like I published an article in the newspaper, a bunch of people read it. You know, I'd walk around Philadelphia and people would say, I read your article, you know, and that was the way in which we thought. People didn't talk back to us so much, right? The only people who talked back to us were friends who'd read something and I was having dinner with and would comment. So for the person who wasn't a writer, right, who didn't have that status as a writer, who hadn't given their life over to writing, what kind of writing did they do? Well, they wrote birthday cards, right? And occasionally there was a very long shot that they'd have a letter to the editor in the newspaper, and that was their life as an author, that very narrow compass. Now, if you think about the way the world has shifted, you know, from the first manifestation of the web to what we used to call Web 2.0, but we don't really use that word anymore because it just seems trivial. This notion of the web being interactive just seems to kind of be baked into the cake now. Right, so what is the web about? It's about authorship, right? So many, many more people engage in some kind of authorship today. It can be something relatively trivial like a Twitter feed or a Facebook page, but actually Twitter feeds and Facebook pages can be far from trivial. I mean, I have tons of friends on Facebook, and my Facebook page is like people kind of having fun, throwing punches, making jokes. I mean, it's actually authorship. It's small little bite-sized pieces. Twitter feeds are the same. You know, newspaper commentators, although they're the worst people in the world, you know, frankly, there's a lot more contestation in newspaper comments than there is in most newspaper articles. So there's a lot of stuff going on, in a sense, on the sideshow. The sideshow sometimes becomes the main show. Now, this is a world in which people, without really thinking about it, have become, many, many people have at least some stake in authorship. They have some notion that they have a say, right? Even if it's difficult to get noticed, even if it's difficult to actually have a readership, it's much easier to have some authorship in your life. And I think, you know, what's going on in the United States now with copyright in part reflects that. So the expansion over the last decade or so of the fair use doctrine, to loosen restrictions on parodic reuse, or forget parodic reuse, just transformative reuse, right? The rise of transformativeness to the kind of top of the factors that work at work in the fair use analysis, the relative freedom we enjoy today, at least for the moment, to make transformative reuses. Think of the result in the Google book case, right? Transformative both in the sense of transforming content, but also transformative in the sense of transforming uses. I think these are related to this feeling, this kind of feeling that's never really articulated, but nonetheless is widely felt, that authorship is now part of most people's lives, or at least a lot of people's lives. We're no longer living in a broadcast culture, right, where few speak to many. We're now living in a culture that's much more of a conversation, where technology actually underlies that shift. And in a world like that, you know, Shansai makes sense, because this is the conversation as it's taking place in China. And in a world like that, you know, a broad permission for transformative reuse makes sense, because this is the conversation as it's taking place in the West. So I think that's the direction we're heading in. And I think, you know, comic books to some degree have been at the leading edge of that, because comic books are, you know, very often, and, you know, I'm a fan of comic books, I've engaged with them for a long time, they're very often at the forefront in ways that, you know, are very informal and digestible and approachable. They're very much at the forefront of cultural criticism. Even when they're not self-consciously so, they often do that kind of work. So I wanted to talk a bit, Jörg, about what you think you wanted the reaction to this book to be, and what you think the reaction has been.
Well, I really want to get sued. First of all, I just wanted people to have lots of fun with it. I mean, I'm a total hypocrite, by the way, because I really, really would love to see a really good Die Hard sequel. I mean, because you know that movie was transformative for me. Because I, you know, when I saw that as a kid, I said, you know, this is what I want to make. You know, I want to make Die Hard, you know, over and over again. And then suddenly, then the sequels came out, and that the sort of admiration for the original, which has never waned, turned gradually into anger because they just keep getting consistently worse. So this is my idea of a Die Hard. This is the most honest and hopefully least hypocritical way that I can do a Die Hard sequel, because I'm actually commenting on being a ripoff artist at the same time. So that was number one. I just wanted to have fun and hopefully also give fun to people. And the other thing was that I am frustrated with the lack of originality out there. I think it is eating us. I think we are currently, from a cultural point of view, in the West, a snake eating its own tail. And I think, and if we continue doing that, we will become insignificant. And in that case, I just cannot wait to, you know, actually hopefully learn Chinese, because, you know, I know that we'll have more interesting stuff and ideas coming out of that part of the world than and from Asia and from Japan, which I've always admired anyway, culturally, than we will out of our own corners here, which are just, which feel, and maybe I'm just paranoid, but they feel more and more corporate. So yes.
So Bart, I wanted to ask you about this question of the stability of the meaning of an icon. Mm. So, you know, Mickey Mouse is a copyrighted character. He's also a trademark, right? And one of the functions of both copyright and trademark law, you know, explicitly trademark law, but by implication copyright law, is to stabilize the meaning of these symbols. So is that a mission that is worth pursuing? And how does it stack up against the kind of countervailing interest that people have in destabilizing the meaning of these symbols, these icons?
There's a really interesting argument by an Israeli law professor who's claimed that because there are property rights protections in trademarks, so she's talking primarily about trademarks, that it may be that over time, it's sort of like this weird evolutionary argument, this is the one set of symbols that will have stable meaning. Whereas all the other symbols, like religious symbols, political symbols, under First Amendment, those are all open to attack and can be completely diluted in their meaning or used and appropriated in all sorts of ways. But property rights mean you can't use Mickey Mouse. You're just not allowed, although this is a good exception of its use. And so this meaning, the meanings in these commercial signs will be stabilized while everything else is falling apart. I'm not sure I accept that as a entirely, but I think it's a very interesting observation that we can watch going forward.
What's the normative takeaway, though? So let's just say descriptively it's right that, you know, the meaning of the crucifix is unstable, which seems to me questionable. But let's assume it is. And the meaning of, you know, the golden arches is stable.
Exactly. Yeah. I think the normative,
is that good or bad?
The normative takeaway is definitely it's dystopian. I mean, it's this idea of a world where the only stable meanings we have left are corporate. And that point, listening to myself say that, I think the argument breaks down. I don't think that's going to happen. But I think the normative takeaway of her argument is that this is a very bad thing. That these corporate signs, which after all are all around us now, in a place like New York, all around us, they are all protected in the stability of their meaning by property rights, whereas everything else is fair game.
But it's, I think, first look at the swastika, which is an interesting trademark.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, because we all know what it's associated with, but it's ironically an ancient Chinese symbol. So it's possibly the most dystopian and creepy form of Shanzai ever. But also it is a logo that's very recognizable in Hollywood entertainment. So if you do if you want to put a bad guy in, you know, the Winter Soldier, which is actually quite a well-crafted Marvel action movie, thankfully there is, you know, once you get a little bit bored, you have a little swastika in there, and it turns out that the bad guys were in fact Nazis who are behind. So you know, Edward Snowden, you know, when he's really against surveillance and stuff like that, you know, don't blame the U.S. government, because in the end, this whole thing was a Nazi invention all along.
So this is funny that you mentioned the swastika. So Zara recently issued a swastika handbag, which, as you might imagine, sparked some protests. And the swastika handbag was designed in Spain, but it was manufactured in India. And the thought was that this was a kind of ancient Buddhist symbol, right? But the recontextualization of the swastika, I think, in the West has been so stable, right? We have a hard time seeing its, you know, 1,000-year-old roots. This argues for the stability of some signs.
Is it the same Zara that also like recently had this little baby grow or something like that actually looked like
a baby concentration camp outfit?
A baby concentration camp.
Yeah, Zara is persistently accidentally anti-Semitic.
Yes. Yeah. So whoever the design director is quite the comedian.
Yes. Okay. So, Charles, I did want to ask you about this stability of meaning in comic books. So. In your experience, do comic book authors, are they eager to take on symbols in this way, like the Air Pirates were, right? They were very self-conscious about it. Are other comic book authors self-conscious about it, or do they just kind of run into trouble accidentally?
You're talking about an enormous class of creativity, so it's very difficult to generalize. But, you know, certainly there's a wide degree of awareness of what has come before and what this says about what, you know, this will be moving forward. I think, again, I firmly believe that you can understand anything if you follow the money. And I think that in terms of comics, the pieces that were perhaps the most influential were the two 1986 books, The Dark Knight Returns by Frank Miller, where using the sanctioned, permitted use of Batman subverted that understanding of Batman as this fixed and stable icon to make a political statement, in contrast to the other DC book, Watchmen, which altered and changed older characters into these wholly new characters. You know, both of those authors were self-aware.
So that is an interesting fork in the road. Could you explain a little bit about that to the folks here, just so they understand what happened
there? Sure.
Because that's interesting on both sides.
Sure. Comics, and again, I think the reason that comics are so influential in our current culture is because there's just a lower financing threshold for a creator to reach an audience than there is with television, film, pretty much anything outside of music. But music, you know, is evocative of mood as opposed to long-form story. And so you're, you know, eternally in a different, you know, realm. You're in the realm of the poet. You're in the realm, you know, of an emotional transaction as opposed to a narrative transaction. Comics as a narrative transaction permits authors with their own native skill and, you know, either a photocopier or now, you know, the technology that we find, you know, on the computer to tell a very broad, very, you know, far appealing story very inexpensively. And so in the case of these two books that were very influential in 1986, those grew out of a business model that basically permitted publishers to sell directly to stores without having to compete in mass. So you solicited, okay, here's this book, stores sent in, I'm gonna order this many. The distributor said, okay, you got orders for 175,000 pieces or whatever it was. They print 185,000, they know they're okay, there's no risk there. That allowed things like DC and Marvel to create new areas of content that they knew for sure were gonna be profitable. They knew for sure going in, we're gonna be able to do this and not, you know, take a risk and lose money. That allowed for, on one hand, this black and white boom that created things like the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles on the mass market side, or Love and Rockets on the literary niche side. It also allowed major corporations like Warner Brothers, who is the parent of DC, to take chances with their characters. And so Frank Miller, who went on to become the motion picture creator and the inspiration for a variety of movies, created a take on Batman that was, what if we mesh Dirty Harry into a satire of the Reagan era and turn this, you know, old character who's turning 50 this year into a grizzled 50-year-old guy and make comments about what all of this means, you know, in the context of a piece of work for hire that was gone along by, you know, everybody on the food chain from the editor up to the publisher and said, yes, you can do this with our property. You know, this is a fixed and a durable symbol, but you can subvert it in this way because it's a consumer product that works. It's a story that works. Watchmen was created by the same company, taking characters that were created by one of the lesser comics publishers, Charlton, and Alan Moore, who went on to inspire a whole host of other literary materials and adaptations with his artist, Dave Gibbons, took these characters and instead of using the ones that were there, deliberately created new ones, you know, that were analogs for what had gone before. And that provides a path where, this is, I think, the path that Jörg took, where we are going to reference these older things, we are going to reference the archetypes, but we're going to change them into these new things for the purposes of this story here today. And so authors today, to answer your question about how self-aware are the creators, I think largely self-aware, but they run down a couple of paths. Do we continue to, you know, in the most charitable way of framing it, create new stories with these durable marks, and the least charitable way of framing it, create fan fiction ad infinitum? Or do we create something either wholly new or something that references, you know, what came before?
I think the wholly new thing here is working into this comic book an observation about how another culture embraces this creativity. So I'm going to open this up to questions, but I'll say when, you know, in the foreword, I expressed a couple of things about Mickey Mouse. So I've always hated Mickey Mouse. I mean, I always thought Mickey Mouse was such a crushing bore and a kind of corporate shill. And, you know, I never understood why he had any power over anybody, right? Kids love him. And I just, you know, I just think, like, why, right? He's so uninteresting. So you take this icon, right, and you transform him into this kind of Chinese version where, in a sense, he finally becomes a little bit interesting. Right? Now, I guess what I wanted to see was, I wanted to see Mickey Mouse get a kicking. And in that sense, Jörg disappointed me. He didn't get a kicking, but I was much more happy than I was disappointed, because what happened here was the recontextualization of a character in a context where, you know, it shows for some reason that the Chinese are fascinated by this icon just like we are, but they're not content just to consume it in this book. They want to do something with it. They want to take some role in its recreation, which I really liked. So with that, could we open this up to questions? And please raise your hand. Scott.
Well, I mean, I don't know. I think artists can generally get away with it more, because unless something is mass-produced, which of course Murakami with books about his art and stuff, it's starting to become that. But if it's a one-off, I guess maybe it's easier to get away with it than if you have a mass-produced and distributed book. I think maybe that, I don't know, I mean, you know, the legal professionals will be able to...
I'm not sure it's doctrinally easier to get away with it, but I think Charles's... observation about following the money has a lot of sense here, because typically the non-mass reproduction is not as threatening to the thing that it's imitating economically.
Yeah, I mean, but I mean, there's one case which I think is, it's loosely related, because it's, I mean, Mouse, for instance, Arch Spiegelman, we were briefly talking about that. He of course made the multiple award-winning Mouse, which is a fantastic book, and that was the first comic book with a mouse in it, I think, that wasn't about cute mice. So perhaps people were also making the connection between Mouse and Mickey Mouse, at least upon picking it up. It's like, oh, wait, a book, comic book with a mouse in it can actually be serious. But then there was this Belgian publisher a couple of years ago called La Cinquième Couche, the fifth layer, I guess. And they made a parodic, they say, version of Mouse called Cats, where they the publisher... Have you heard of that one? Oh, wow. Okay, so this is... So the publisher, who's actually Jewish, and an artist who also is Jewish, so they're not anti-Semites or something, at least I hope not, they decided to make this book called Cats. They believed that Arch Spiegelman was actually making a bad point, and actually his oral argument was not working out at all, and was actually inherently racist.
So could I just backfill a little bit? So Mouse is a graphic novel about experience in a concentration camp, and in the different characters are drawn as different animals, right?
So nationalities are right. Different animals. So all the Jews are mice, all the Poles are pigs, and all the Germans are cats. And what the Belgian publisher did is they thought that is profoundly racist, because, you know, this is proving to those that are actual really in fact racist that we are different species.
It just recapitulates a German argument
about race. Yeah. And so what they did is they scanned in every page from Mouse. So I'm getting confused now, and replaced all of the animals' heads with cat heads. So suddenly it was just cats, and you had Nazi cats, and, you know, Jewish cats, and Polish non-Jewish cats, and whatever. They were distributing copies of it at Angoulême, which is the sort of like the top European comic book festival. And you could buy it at pretty much every Belgian publisher's booth and stuff like that. And they got sued, I mean, immediately, next day by the French publisher of Mouse. And that didn't end very well. The publisher then was forced to destroy all existing copies of the book, which they then took full advantage of. And then they organized this very ceremonial book burning, which of course in the context of a Holocaust story was rather ironic. I'm really curious why, because I mean they said like, if we had put red noses on all the cats, he said to me, this publisher, I saw him a few months ago at the same festival, then people would have clearly understood, okay, this is a parody. But we didn't do that. It was still black and white, and it was all still very serious and all that stuff. But to us, it was inherently a parody, but we lost this war.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering if that's, you know, members of the audience, et cetera, was that a fair thing? What do you think? Is that a parody? Should people be allowed to do that or not?
So for me, I think we get off on the wrong foot when we talk about parody as something special. So for me, parody is an element of reuse, but there are also other elements of reuse that I think are interesting. So there's just frontal assault, which is not parody, right? So The Wind Ungone is a great example. So The Wind Ungone is a book that basically retells Gone with the Wind, right, in a very scathing way. It retells it from the perspective of the slaves in the house. And, you know, the U.S. courts that looked at the copyright issues surrounding this, you know, the Alice Randall who wrote that book was sued, and the courts finally held that this was a fair use because it was parodic. Now, it's not parodic. It's just mean. It's just, you know, it's an attack. It's a critique. And that's valuable. I mean, parody is just one form of critique, but why we're privileging it in these discussions, I've never understood. So mm-hmm. I would say that Cats, you know, we talked about this a while ago. I went and looked at it. Cats is, it's just a critique. It's actually a very effective, right, fair, in my view, critique. And if they put red noses on it, it would just be stupid, right? So the stupid element is pointed out by this comedian, Nathan Fillion. Do you know this guy? He has this show on Comedy Central where he's a management consultant.
Nathan Fillion, he's the guy from Serenity, isn't he?
No, Nathan, some other guy.
Okay.
Anyway. Sorry, different Nathan. Anyway, so he has the show where he gives ridiculous business advice.
Oh,
to
fake
businesses.
Starbucks.
Yeah, yes. Dumb Starbucks.
So brilliant.
He basically opens a Starbucks. It's not a Starbucks, but it looks exactly like a Starbucks. And he just puts the word dumb in front of everything. And he says, so this is protected because it's a parody, right? So this, I think, is a parody of the concept of parody. which I thought was pretty effective, and it points out how parody, I think, as a kind of special case in copyright law and in trademark law to some degree, has been oversold. Other questions? Yeah. Yeah, who wants to take that?
Well, one thing that one of the biggest corporations in the world, Microsoft, a few days ago bought the developer of Minecraft, which And Minecraft is the game that Lego executives beat themselves up over not having made themselves every day, because it's essentially Legos in a virtual world.
And completely addictive.
Completely addictive, and it's extraordinary because you build a platform that obviously costs money to buy into and to subscribe to, etc. But everyone gets to build their own world within it and make with it as they may. So it's awesome. But in a way, we've always had that. We've always had Lego since we were growing up. For some reason, at some point, we grow out of it, and then we feel that we have to belong to corporations and do our jobs and whatever. And building stuff out of a big toy box is no longer acceptable. But then there was, of course, the Lego movie, which is brilliant because it's both corporate, very corporate, because it's a branded product with lots of other brands within it, like Batman, although there's a sort of a silly version of Batman in there.
It's all Warner Brothers.
It's all Warner Brothers product, yeah, except for Lego. And it's and even though it is a branded exercise and it's kind of, creepily corporate, at the same time, it's also about not being corporate, and the whole story is a dystopian world where you're not allowed to be an individual, and where you have to do things a certain way. But then this sort of a child's sort of creativity becomes a piece of a dangerous commodity. And I think, I don't know, maybe some corporations are getting it. I mean, they're giving us toy boxes at least. But as soon as those toy boxes then generate products that start making money with their tools, then we become dangerous again, right?
Well, there's a certain mollifying effect that's happening here. I mean, it's even present, and I don't mean this disparagingly, but it's even present in Ricky Rouse. I mean, the thing that welcomes this war deserter back into the bosom of the West is actually upholding the values that, the heroic values of Mickey Mouse, that were there. The Lego movie is basically saying, we know people are using this, so now we need to figure out a way to monetize this.
Yes.
So, it's all a matter of, you're mollifying and allowing these uses within the context of the consumer product that, we're making here, and letting the consumer product evolve as a product. But
yes,
that doesn't necessarily make, new and authentic culture. And I think, to the point that the gentleman raised here, it's important to define our terms. Like, manga didn't appropriate, it was inspired, right? There's a difference between inspiration from what comes before, appropriating these materials deliberately, which hip-hop did, and then copying for the purpose of frontal assault, which Cats did. Cats, if you're describing it, if I'm understanding the way you're describing it, actually took Art Spiegelman's real lines that he drew,
yes,
and then altered them in a way that was designed to be an assault. And that's a whole different question is it right to take that author's line, that author's writing, and then alter it in this fashion? That's a different question from what is the meaning of Mickey Mouse, and is that something that I can appropriate in this fashion? So there's all kinds of gradations here that are going to be the battleground of the next 50 years, but there's no pat answer to any of it.
All right, so I'm going to have to leave it there. We've run over time. Thank you all for coming. Really appreciate it. Jörg actually has some books here if anyone's interested. See Maya, who can identify herself. There she is. Thanks all for coming. We appreciate it.